Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Peace be with you.
Also with you.
I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Amen. Good to be here today. And as you know, this is our associate pastor's last Sunday in that role as he is preparing to retire. So he's going to be bringing the word today for us. And then immediately following the service, we'll be going outside for a retirement party out in our picnic pavilion, so I hope you'll join us out there. I got hamburgers and hot dogs. The deacons have been here since early this morning getting everything ready for us, so we're going to be able to move right out into the pavilion without delay and start eating. So, all right, so why don't we give our time to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your great and awesome love for your people, for us. We thank you for this Sunday as we celebrate the body of Christ. We know, Holy Spirit, you designed the body. We are designed with various members in the body. We are designed with your timetable in mind. And there are different seasons in our lives and different seasons in our churches, different seasons in our nation and in the world. And we are grateful for today, in particular, as we celebrate your design of the body and that part that Richard and his wife Joanne have played in this body, not only for these past 12 years, but for many years prior to that, before he came into the position officially as an associate pastor here. And Lord, we're grateful he'll be continuing to serve in this body following his retirement. We're grateful, Lord, for your design, for all of your goodness and your grace. We just want to commit this time to you, the service to you. Lord, we do this in the name of, above every name, the name of Jesus. Father, we come to you in his mighty and precious name as we enter into worship. Amen.
Lord, we just invite your presence. We thank you for who you are. We honor you in this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord for the things he has done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord for the things he is doing. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord for all things yet to come. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, I praise the Lord. I lift my hands up to you, I lift my hands. I lift my hands up to you, I lift my hands. I lift my hands up to you, for all that you do, I lift my hands. Up to you, I lift my hands. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord for the things he has done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord for the things he is doing. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord for all things yet to come. Praise the Lord. My eyes up to you, I lift my eyes. I lift my eyes up to you, I lift my eyes. I lift my eyes up to you, for all that you do, I lift my eyes up to you, I lift my eyes. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, for the things He is doing. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, for all things yet to come. I praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Voices raise to Jesus, sing to the King.
on him, Lord. Crown him, Lord. Crown him, Lord of all.
Proverbs 22:11 says, he who loves purity of heart and has grace on his lips, the king will be his friend.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved wretched like me.
Praise God. Let's pray over our offering. Father God, we thank you for this morning, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to congregate and, Lord, to meet in your name, Lord. And, Lord, I just pray for the tithes and the offerings this morning, Lord, that we would just give back a portion of what you've given to us, Lord. And, Lord, I pray that as a church, Lord, that you would give us wisdom on how to use these tithes and offerings, Lord. God, I thank you for your amazing grace, and it's because of your amazing grace that was freely bought for us at the cross, Lord, that we are all here this morning, Lord. And so we celebrate the amazing grace, Lord, that you show us today and that you will continue to show us. And Lord, I just lift up Pastor Richard this morning, Lord, with so many different emotions going through his mind and heart, Lord. I just pray, Lord, that you would, through your working of the Holy Spirit, Lord, that you would calm him, Lord, and that you would just, through him, Lord, speak, Lord. Be his mouthpiece this morning, Lord, that we would hear him proclaim your word this morning. And so, Father, we, again, thank you for this opportunity to meet. We ask that you would bless the tithes and offerings this morning, and Lord, we submit to you this morning, and we give you all glory and honor, and we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Any of you here that have played sports before, and before a game, you're so nervous, your legs feel like they're so weak, you can't hardly stand. You feel like you're just like ready to just fall. Well, let me tell you something, and you're like so wound up, and it's like, okay, I think I can do this. And so, but then once you get into the game and you start playing, you know, everything settles. And so I'm just praying and asking that Holy Spirit will just help me to settle and just share what he has laid upon my heart today. And, you know, again, as we all know, today is the last day as officially as associate pastor, and Jim asked that I would speak. And so Hazel here? She's not here. She goes, oh, so Jim wants you to go out with a bang. And I said, well, I don't know about a bang, but he wants me to go out. And so we're going out. And then there's a right, just go out. You know, I don't care about the bang. The bang might be the door. Well, you know the rest of the story. And so here's the other thing. So I thought and prayed about what, you know, I just like, Lord, man, there's so many things. So many things that you want to say, so many things that just roll through your mind, and all the emotions and the relationships and all of that. And so I was like, Lord, you've got to give me what to say. And so I'm just going to share what I feel like the Lord's laid on my heart today. And there's another thing that I want to share with you. Here's the thing. Keep it short and sweet, right? Because here, there we go. I knew I was going to get an amen out of that. I just figured it must have come from Bob, right? And so here's the thing. There you go. And so they may not remember what you say, but they'll remember if you go long. So anyway, let's go ahead and launch. I want you to turn to Matthew 7, 24 through 29. That's where we're going to spend just some time there. Before we do, and while you're getting there, let's just kind of set the stage. As you know, this is early on in Jesus' ministry. He's already called several of his disciples, and he's going into the synagogues, and he's preaching kingdom, the good news of the kingdom, right? The good news of the kingdom, and he's going around preaching. And what else is going on? people are getting healed. He's praying for people, and they're getting healed of diseases. They're getting set free from demonic oppression. They're getting the blind are able to see. Those who can't walk, they can now walk. I mean, and so all of this is going on. And so what do you think is going to happen? People start telling other people, hey, you need to hear what this Jesus guy is saying. And not only on top of that, guess what he's doing? People are getting healed coming to this Jesus. And so the word gets out. And so what happens? I mean, if we hear that, what are we going to do? We're going to go. And so the crowds start building and the crowds start building. And so here he is. And then this leads us up to the time of the Sermon on the Mount. And if we've been blessed to be able to go to Israel, because you guys blessed Joanne and I to be able to do that a few years ago, where the Sermon on the Mount is. Of course, we wouldn't call it necessarily a mountain here, but it's this just long, flowing hill that goes up and overlooks the Sea of Galilee. Just absolutely beautiful, and even the acoustics of it. And so it says that Jesus went up on this hill or this mountain, you know, range, whatever, and he calls his disciples to him, and he starts to teach them. Of course, all the crowds gather there as well. And he teaches them what we now know to be the Sermon on the Mount. And that sermon, what is the heart of the Sermon on the Mount? It's how we as Christians, this is what the kingdom of God looks like and is lived out here on earth. But here's the thing, it looks so differently in so many ways, what we've been taught or what we think or how we think about things, right? I just got a few things listed here. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the peacemakers. You, your salt and your light in a dark world. You have heard it said, I love these, right? You have heard it said, do not murder. But I say to you, fall into judgment, right? Do not murder, you fall into judgment. I say to you, even if you get angry at your brother, you fall into judgment. Oh, man, this is really getting hard now. Men, women too, but most really men, right? You have heard it say, do not commit adultery. But I say to you, if you even lust after another woman in your heart, you have already committed the act of adultery. This is getting hard quick. Don't judge. Don't lie. Let your yes be your yes. Don't take oaths. Let your yes be your yes. Be a person, a man, a woman, a person of integrity. Let your yes be your yes and your no be your no. Don't make oaths. Right? And it goes on. Oh, here's one. They slap you on the face, turn and give them the other side. This is a message counter to what we're hearing today, isn't it? This is hard. Let me give you this one. You have heard it said, love your neighbor as yourself, or love your neighbor, but hate your enemy. I tell you that love your neighbor and love your enemy. And it goes on. This whole message turns everything upside down about the way we know of this earth. It turns it all upside down. And Jesus said, this is what it looks like to live out kingdom reality here on earth as a follower of Jesus Christ. And then at the very end, he finishes up with this parable. This is where we're going to pick up. Matthew 7, 24 through 29. Therefore, okay, right? Don't you love the therefores? I've given you all this. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a sensible or wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain fell, the rivers rose, and the winds blew and pounded that house, yet it didn't collapse. But its foundation was on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and doesn't act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain fell, the rivers rose, the wind blew and pounded that house, and it collapsed, and its collapse was great. When Jesus had finished his sermon, the crowds were astonished at his teaching because he was teaching them with one who had authority and not like the scribes. Two foundations. Foundation, the rock, Jesus Christ. The world and every other foundation. Two foundations. One will stand the test of time. We know this, right? One will stand the test of time. The other will not. It will crumble. It will fall. As many of you know, before I was called into full-time ministry, I worked in construction. In my first 4 years in construction, I worked for a concrete company. And so very early on, I learned the importance of a solid foundation. If you know anything about construction at all, you know what's the first thing that goes in. And most foundations are made of what? Concrete. And so that's, you just learn. And here's the thing, what you come to learn and understand very quickly is if you don't build the foundation properly, everything that you build on top of that is going to fall. It's going to fall. Now, if you build it properly, everything you build on top of it will support everything that you stack on top of it. And the first thing I want to talk about here in this passage is, I want to hit on this, deception. Things aren't always what they appear to be, right? Deception, the enemy has used it right from the very beginning. Right from the very beginning of the fall, deception is the tool of the enemy. And let me explain to what I mean by this. Matt and I were talking about this the other day. And, you know, Jesus had this remarkable ability to tell stories and parables in such a way that when you heard them, it was just like, yeah, that makes sense. I got it, right? But sometimes for us, it's a little bit harder to grasp some of these. We were talking about it the other day. If you're a new believer and you open up the Bible and you were reading it and it says, you cannot pour new wine into old wineskins, you'd be like, what in the world is that all about? Right? So you have to dig and you have to study and you have to understand, you know, the impact of that parable, of that story in that day and in that time. What about the Good Shepherd? Now, we kind of understand that one a little bit more, but let me tell you, unless you're a sheep herder, you know, then you start to understand all the nuances of herding sheep and protecting sheep and watching out for them. Then you come to have a better understanding of this parable of the Good Shepherd, right? And even being a sheep herder today is nothing like being a sheep herder back in Jesus' day. So anyway, it just helps you understand. You're like, well, what's your point, Richard? What's your point? Because in this parable, as you read it, you know, the first question that came to my mind probably the first time I read it is, well, why would anyone build on sand anyway? We know, right? All right, Bill, answer the question. Bill's sitting there laughing. In our day and age, why would anybody build on sand anyway? So it could sink. So fall. We know if you do that, what's the outcome going to be? Not good, right? But let me talk a little bit more about this. If you're at the Sea of Galilee, again, think about where Jesus is at. He's up on this hill overlooking the Sea of Galilee. In the summer times, the sun would get so hot and the water would recede a little bit. And what it would do, it would literally bake. It would bake that sand and it would bake it. And it would get harder and harder and harder. You see where I'm going with this, right? So man comes along, and he's going to, and if you're up there, you see all these houses built around the Sea of Galilee. And so a man comes along, and he's like, I'm going to build a home. I'm going to build it, and it looks good, it feels good, it's solid, it's hard. You know what? The animals are running across it, you know, we're dragging wagons or whatever it is across it, it's hard, it's solid, I can build on it. But then what you have is you have someone that comes along and says, hey, man, what are you doing? He's like, I'm building my house here. And he says, look, I'm telling you, that's not a good foundation. And what does he say? Look, it's solid. I got it. It's good. All right, man, I'm just telling you. So then you got another guy. He comes over here, and he's a little wiser, been around the block a few times. And he's building his house. And he's like, you know what? I know better. And he starts digging. And he starts digging. And he starts digging. Why is he digging? What's below that hard, what appears to be a hard foundation, a good solid foundation, is what? Bedrock. There's bedrock underneath there. So what appears, again, deception, everything that appears to be good here is not what you're going to build on. You're going to dig down deep and you're going to build on that bedrock. That's the foundation. And then what does it tell us? What does it tell us? The storms come. Now, it doesn't say the storm came just against the guy who built on the sand. The storms came against the guy who built on the rock as well. And it pounded and it pounded and it pounded. But here's the thing. The house that was built on the rock stood. It stood the test of time. It stood the pounding. It stood all the storms. The other one crumbled and fell. When I was in construction, we would have soil engineers come out to the job site. Right? Bill knows this. That you go out, you dig, and the first thing you do is soil engineer comes out, and he tests that soil to make sure that you can put that concrete in the ground. He's going to make sure. And here's the thing. You're not putting concrete in there until he tells you that it's suitable to do so. Now, I used to hate this. You know, you dig and you dig and you dig and you're like, man, we're good. We're good. And he comes out here with little tools and everything. And he prods and he pokes and he does these little tests and he goes, not good enough. And you're like, come on, man, it's good. I'm telling you it's good. And he's like, no, everything that I know about soil, it's not good enough. You got to dig down some more. Here's my point. He was the one. He was the expert. The soil engineer is the one. I knew nothing about soil. He was the expert. He was the one that was going to guide me. My dependence on building a firm foundation was not on me of knowing the soil. It was on him. The foundation, I was dependent on the soil engineer. He was the one who was going to tell me. My dependence was on him. I depended on his expertise. He's the one who told me what I could do, and then I knew that I was building on a suitable foundation. I say all this to say, look, nothing new from old to today, but there is a tremendous amount of deception. There's a lot going on in our culture today, a lot of craziness, and there's a lot of deception. This is nothing new. We read in New Testament times, Old Testament times, deception is the work of the enemy. But I'm here to tell you that the firm foundation and the only foundation that we need to be building on is that of Jesus Christ, right? Because here's the thing. If you start buying into some of this stuff, and I'm not talking about just what's going on here politically. I'm talking about, stuff that's fed to our families over years and years, our children. You know what? If I want to lead my children and raise my children on a firm foundation, guess what? I need to raise them in the foundation of Jesus Christ. If I want to be a good husband and a good father, you know what? That's founded on the rock of Jesus Christ and nothing else. And let me tell you, you'll have people, you young folks, I'm telling you, I want to share this with you young folks. Stand solid on the rock of Jesus. I'm telling you, you'll hear so much stuff that this culture will throw at you. And if you're not careful, you'll find yourself building on a rock that will not stand the test of time. I'm telling you. And so here's the thing. We build that foundation on Jesus. Jesus is calling out. And here's the thing, too. Think about it. What foundation is he challenging in that time when he's giving this talk? The foundation of the religious establishment, of religion and legalism. He's like, look, that's not going to stand. That's not it. He's challenging that, and he's saying, hey, look, it's me or this faulty foundation. And so do me a favor. Turn to Matthew 16, 13 through 19. We all know this is Peter's confession of the Messiah, right? When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do you say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others Jeremiah, one of the prophets. But you, he asked them, who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus responded, Simon, son of Jonah, you are blessed because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will what? I will build my church. And the forces or the gates of Hades, gates of hell, will not overpower it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth is already bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth is already loosed in heaven. Listen, our foundation, the rock in which we stand, is that of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And here's the thing, the profession, the proclamation of the church is founded on what Peter was proclaiming and what everything is proclaimed from there on, is that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. Jesus Christ, who lived in glory, who emptied himself to come, emptied himself so that he'd take on the sin of you, the sin of me, all of us, the sin of the world. And as Matt talked about it about a month ago, what did he say? And we're the ones who drove those spikes. He took that sin of each and every one of us, and he took it to the cross. Right? That's the foundation that we're on. That Jesus Christ came and died for each and every one of us. And only because he died for each and every one of us do we have eternal life. And it doesn't end there. It doesn't end there. He overcame death. He overcame sin. Right? And what does it say? He went down into hell. Forgive me, little kids. But he snatched the keys away from Satan. He snatched them away, and he unlocked the gates, he unlocked the chains, and he set the captives free. And the truth of the gospel is, in Christ, you are free indeed. The foundation is Jesus Christ. Let's go back to Matthew 7 for just a second. Jesus says that everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them, what did he say? Acts on them. It's like a sensible man or wise man who built his house on the rock. Our foundation is not just based on our profession of faith in Jesus Christ. Yes, that's our starting point, but it is solidified on how we live it out. Right? It's not just hearing, but it's doing. We've heard this before, right? A surrendered life to Jesus Christ brings about a transformed life, which in turn produces a life of works filled with kingdom purpose. James 1, we know what James says, right? It's like a man who is born, looks in the mirror and forgets what he looks like and goes about his business. Faith and works coming together. I want to personalize things here a little bit. I told you I'm going to keep it short and sweet. I want to personalize a couple things. Let me ask you a question. How do you know someone is trustworthy? How do you know someone is trustworthy? I'm going to tell you a little story. It's just personal. Here's how it works. How you know someone is trustworthy. When I was 21, Joanne was 22. And yes, for the record, that you all know now that Joanne is older than I am. All right? So now I won't be in trouble for that one. All right? This is a message about grace, right? Come on now. All right. I was 21. Joanne was 22. We got married. Here's the thing. At that time when we got married, I placed my faith in her, and she placed her faith in me, that we were both trustworthy, right, and would be trustworthy throughout this journey of our marriage. But here's the thing. In reality, that was a step of faith on her part, and it was a step of faith on my part, that we were going to be trustworthy to each other. And here's the thing. Let's be honest. Anyone who enters into marriage, it is a step of faith, isn't it? It's a step of faith that each other is going to be trustworthy in that relationship with each other. There's no guarantees. And let me be clear, this is not just about being trustworthy in the area of, you know, fidelity. It's in all areas of life, all areas of this, all aspects of this relationship. Are you going to be trustworthy? I can tell you that after 40 years, Joanne is a trustworthy person. She's trustworthy. She's a trustworthy wife. She's a trustworthy mother. She's a trustworthy friend. She's a trustworthy father, follower of Christ. She is trustworthy. Top to bottom. How do I know? Because 40, guess what? This December, we're going to be married for 40 years. 40 years. Man, that's a long time. But it's been a good 40 years, Joanne. Yeah, sometimes it feels longer than others, all right? Okay. How do I know? How do I know? Because she's been trustworthy throughout those 40 years. I've seen it. I've seen it every day, day in and day out. Now, let me go a little bit deeper here. 20-something years ago, as you all know, and I've shared this story many times, I'm not going to go into all the details of my conversion, but 20-something years ago, Joanne, I wasn't raised in a Christian home, wasn't brought, raised going to church. So this is maybe for some of those who don't know this that are watching. But here's the thing. We started visiting my sister in Waynesboro, and we started going to a church there. Traditional Lutheran organ playing church. Quiet. But let me tell you something. And the Lord had been working on me, and there's a lot that surrounded this point in time. But at some point, there was one day, we attended church with them, and we're sitting in the pew. And I'm here to tell you that I don't know how else to say it other than this. The Lord had brought me to a point where I knew and I understood that it was time to surrender my life to Jesus Christ. There was no question about it. And I'm sitting in that pew, and the organ's playing, and like I said, it was a communion service, so it was quiet. My eyes are closed. And Matt talked about this last week. Let me tell you something. It's spiritual warfare. Because I'm going to tell you what was going on in me was I was hearing all kinds of crazy lies in my head. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't know this is going to happen to you. This is going to happen to your wife. And I'm telling you, I'm not exaggerating this. This is going to happen to your wife. This is what's going to happen to your kids. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Loud. Just screaming in my head, don't do it. And as I sat in that pew, I can tell you that a peace and a presence came upon me like I have never, ever, 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 ever experienced in my life. Nothing I've experienced like that in my life. And here's what I heard. And I say here because sometimes we use that term and it's sort of audible, it's sort of not, you know, more times not, right? But it's about as audible as it could get. And with that peace and with that presence, here's what I heard. Just trust me. Just trust me. Now look, and at that point I said, Jesus, I trust you. I give you everything. I give you my life. And by rights, I give you my wife. I give you my children. I give you my job. I give you everything. I submitted. I gave it all. I said, it's yours. It's yours. I give it to you. And let me tell you this. 20-something years, I can sit here and tell you that Jesus Christ is trustworthy. Jesus Christ is trustworthy. And I share, and we all know this, right? The message today is very basic. It's very simple. We get it. We understand, right? We're Christians. We're all believers here. But you know what? There might be someone in here. There might be someone that's listening to this via live stream. And here's my message to you today. If you haven't trusted your life to Jesus Christ, don't put it off. Let me tell you, he is trustworthy. You will not regret it. Your life will be changed and transformed like you could not imagine. And so here it is 20-something years later. And I will tell you that Jesus Christ is absolutely 100% trustworthy. But it does start, just like in that marriage, almost 40 years ago. Wow. It starts with a step of faith. Take that step of faith. All right. All right. I got one more thing I wanted to share, but I asked Joanne if she had anything she wanted to share first. So we're going to do that. You got me, BJ? I'm putting her on the spot. I'll pay for this one later, too.
Yes, he will.
It's not a total surprise. I told her I was going to do this.
Well, very short and sweet, and because I'm not going to be able to hold it together, but I just want to thank everyone for all their love and support they've given us through the years and even before he came on staff. I mean, you guys have always been here for us and everything, so I just want to thank you very much.
Well, and again, I could sit up here all day long, which I know you don't want me to do, and tell you how much I appreciate you guys, how good this church has been to us. Again, serving in the body of Christ, then being called on, and I've shared this when I gave my notice that I was going to be retiring, is, look, let me tell you, when I felt that call to walk away from my career that I was in and to go into full-time ministry, this church supported me all along the way. They supported Joanne and I. And I mean, I could just sit up here, but I can't express my gratitude enough for all of you and for many that aren't here, but maybe watching or have, you know, life goes on, people move on, right? We are a body of Christ. We don't do this by ourselves. And let me say this too. This church is built on a firm foundation. It's built on a firm foundation and Jim is the leader of that. He's in the scripture, he teaches the scripture, he teaches Jesus Christ. And you know what? You know, sometimes we get lost in all the bells and the whistles of life. But let me tell you, there's a firm foundation here. And guess what? When was this church established? 1889. It's not still here because it's because it's built and the word of God is preached here. And I want to personally thank Jim for giving me that opportunity years ago when I came to him and said, hey, here's what I feel like the Lord is doing. You know, he shared what the Lord laid on his heart, and you know, that he and this entire church support us every single step of the way. And I can't say thank you enough, but thank you is what I got. And we love you guys. And I want to share one other thing. It's just simple. This is Paul's writing a letter to the Philippians, and you know that Paul had this special love for the Philippians, you know, and he was writing them and to encourage them. And it's verse 27, and it reads like this, just one thing. I don't know, this just jumped out at me the other day, and I just wanted you to receive this as well. Just one thing, live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel. Live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Right? Maybe we all do that and do it together. Love you guys. Thanks.
All right. Well, it's a sad day in many ways, I know, but again, we rejoice that Richard and Joanne are going to be continuing to be a part of the body here. Richard is a key part of bringing me here. So he was on the pastor search team way back then, 1999, and we just connected. And so he's a big reason why I'm here. So if you haven't forgiven him for that yet, now's the day. You need to do it today. All right? And then in 2008, he began his time here as associate pastor July 1st. So he will have completed exactly 12 years at the end of this month. When we installed him as associate pastor, I gave him a big sign that said complaint department. It was supposed to go on his door, but I don't know what happened to that sign. He got rid of that thing. But anyway, there's a lot that I could say, certainly, and a lot I know you all want to say to him. And he's going to be in here for a few minutes anyway before going outside, just in case you're not going to be joining us outside. But you certainly have plenty of opportunity to speak with him either in here or out there. So I just wanted to ask them to come on up. Two very, very wonderful, special people. And I love you both. So our sons were kind of like stair steps with their sons. So they were very close in age. And they live not exactly right across the street, but pretty much, you know, from us. And so our boys grew up with their boys. And so there's always been a close connection there. So it's just been a wonderful delight to know them. And so, Richard, I had these lovely flowers for you.
Thanks, man. I appreciate that.
Can I give them to her? Well, I have a very lovely very lovely check for Joanne. All right. So but we do love y'all. Inside the card is just a token of our appreciation, and you know, it's one of those practical gifts, right? One size fits all. It can be used for a lot of things. So anyway, we want to pray for these two, and we want to pray for our time as we go outside. Lord, we thank you for Richard and for Joanne and their service here. We thank you for all that you have done in their lives. Thank you for their willingness to step into this role. I've always said you have to either be crazy or committed to serve as a pastor. Usually helps to be a little bit of both, or a lot of both. And so, Lord, I just thank you that Richard and Joanne took that step of faith, because it is something that has to be walked out as a couple in so many ways. And so, Lord, I thank you for his obedience to you. I thank you for the way you have worked in their lives to draw them to yourself. Lord, we just bless them in your name. We bless them as they enter into a new season of life. I know Joanne's going to keep working for at least a little while at the school, but they've got things they want to do. They've got some plans. And so, Lord, I just pray that you would refresh them, help them to follow your lead in everything from this point forward, because I know they're not retiring from serving you. Richard's retiring from this particular means of service here, but there's no retirement from the kingdom of heaven. And so, Lord, he's one of your faithful servants, and I know he's going to continue to serve you faithfully in so many ways, including some very important ways right here in this congregation. So, Lord, we bless them. We thank you for them. And we just want to bless the time of food and fellowship to follow this service. And we give you all honor and glory for our brother and sister in Christ. We love them, Lord. We thank you that you gave them to us as the gift they are. And we bless your holy name. In the name above every name, the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Bless you. Love you both. Give you a man. All right. So please speak with them. Let them know. Share the things you'd like to share with them. If you want to remain in here for prayer, we would be happy to pray for you. We are going to be moving directly outside to the pavilion. Please join us. Again, food is ready to go, hamburgers, hot dogs, chips, and other things. People brought side dishes and desserts. We're ready to move right on out there. So please join us. If you were not able to bring anything with you, that's fine. Please just come and join the time of fellowship, and let's spend some time together as a body of Christ. You know, we've all been locked up for a long time with this COVID-19 thing. So it's good to be able to gather and share food together. Lord, we ask that you dismiss us covered with your presence and your glory. We thank you for the end of one season as we anticipate the beginning of another season. Lord, we know that our times and our seasons are in your hands. And so we thank you for this season past, or that is coming to an end now. And we thank you for this season ahead, for all that you have done and all that you will do. We give you honor and glory in and through the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, the name above every name. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Please join us. Father, we pray a blessing over the food we're about to share. In the name of Jesus, amen.